And I can understand how this can be a little confusing. It's like, wait, Jamal, we've been talking about mental and emotional health and well-being, trying to be beneficial and stuff like that. How in the world did we get here? What up, Black man? Welcome to the Beneficial Black Man Podcast, where we focus on helping Black men to overcome mediocrity to become beneficial for their community by discussing faith, creativity, personal development, and mental and emotional health management. I'm your host, Jamal Calpin. What's going on? What's going on? Hope you all are doing well, finding time for an emotional release valve, protecting your mental, and steadily becoming beneficial. So this episode, I'm just going to be honest with you up front, this one might be a little different from the other episodes that we've done before. Thank you for supporting me up until episode 50. This is a milestone. I'm excited about this. Episode 50, we are making headway. We are doing things. This is exciting. Yes, like I said, this episode might be a little, this might be one of the nerdiest, geekiest, strangest episodes, but I'm leaning in to this weird aspect of myself or whatever, right? The whole concept of this episode and what I really want to get across is why it's so important for us as men, as Black men, we got to get our minds right. We have to. It's so very, very, very important. The emphasis behind that is there is an enemy out in this world. Regardless of your individual beliefs or things like that, there is an opposition to us as Black people, but to humanity as a whole. And this enemy, and there are a lot of different names. People want to call it the devil, Satan. Ralph Smart likes to call them the inorganic ones, whether you want to be like the dark side, whatever, whatever opposite evil entity you want to say exists. But there is an enemy that desires to devour us. One of the main ways we fight back is by having good thinking, by making sure that we are in our right mind and that we are thinking well and living up to a standard. I honestly believe that. And a scripture that I want to share first before we get into the interesting stuff is 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 and 6. And this passage of scripture has been very helpful for me in my mental health journey and also my spiritual walk. But it's 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 6, which read, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled." In this war, in this fight, again, whether it's you want to think of it as in, you know, fighting against the dark side or fighting against inorganic ones or fighting against the enemy of our soul, whatever. The weapons of our warfare aren't carnal. It isn't just hands, swords, guns, whatever. It starts with our thoughts, dealing with imaginations, dealing with ideations, dealing with things that happen in the intangible, in the invisible realm. And it starts with our minds and our emotions and all of that. And when we are taking captive those thoughts, when we're taking captive and fighting against these bad ideas and these imaginations and these invisible things and choosing to walk in a good way, in a beneficial way, by upholding a standard and doing the things that are most beneficial for us as a people, we fight back. That's just one of the weapons of our warfare. As on this podcast, and I've mentioned before on this channel, when we think better, we can be better so that we can do better. This is might be somewhat of a strange episode. Because I'm kind of talking about stuff that may be considered like conspiracy theories and kind of far out there and stuff like that. But I believe it's really, really important at this point in time in life, in this season of existence, that we have to get our minds right. We have to position ourselves to be thinking well, living as beneficial as we can, and doing our best to fight against the opposition that's coming towards us. And it's happening in manifesting itself in so many different ways, whether it's you're seeing how crazy the economy is, you're seeing all of the uprisings and revolts that are happening in various countries all over the world. You can see it in healthcare, you know, especially after 2020, how a lot of people just questioned and are concerned about what the powers that be are doing to us as people, what they're doing to us in our food, what they're doing to like our water, what they're doing to our air, like with chemtrails and things related to planes. There's a lot of stuff happening that's really trying to take away our humanity, that's trying to take away our quality of life and trying to mess us up. And a lot of that is happening because those who are supposed to be fighting back aren't, or the ones who are fighting back are being erased more or less. We're trying to provide alternatives, trying to provide help for mankind. There's a real weird fight going on. Part of that fight, part of their weapons against us is distraction, keeping us away from what's really going on, what's covertly and sometimes even overtly happening. But we have to fight. One of the best ways that we fight is by getting our minds right so that we can be better, so that we can do better. So I've mentioned before in previous episodes, this idea that can be seen in the Bible about the impacts and the effects of wicked men rising or coming to prominence within a society, within a culture. I'll read two verses that relate to that or that I've mentioned before. They are Proverbs chapter 28, verses 12 and 28. Proverbs chapter 28, verse 12 reads, "When righteous men do rejoice, there is great glory. But when the wicked rise, a man is hidden." And verse 28 reads, "When the wicked rise, men hide themselves. But when they perish, the righteous increase." Again, like I mentioned before, it's imperative that we, particularly as men, continue to strive to become beneficial, to stand up and to be righteous, to defend those who are fatherless, those who are without covering, those who are weak, those who are oppressed. We have to stand up and fight, because if we don't, the wicked rise. And that's what's been happening for quite some time. Whether it's in various nations throughout time, evil men come to places of power. They wreak havoc and then eventually, you know, it falls apart or whatever. But that cycle doesn't have to keep going if we actually do the work to stand up and fight against it. And I think we are in a season where we need to stand up. We need to fight. That's been impacting us as a community, particularly as the Black community. We're seeing this impact other communities as well. Again, whether people know it or not, particularly here in the States, there is a lot of crazy stuff happening, and it's related to the rise of wicked people, the rise of wicked men in our society. As I mentioned, this idea, this concept of the rise of wicked men, and we're seeing it more and more in our society, right? A couple of verses that kind of tie into that, at least in my understanding, and this whole concept of why it's so important that we get our thinking straight, that we make an effort to think better, to have good thinking, so that we are in better mental and emotional health and well-being. Because as men, we need to be present. We need to stand up against the wicked and the wiles and the crazy stuff, that's happening in our world, particularly for our community. So there's this parable that Jesus shares. Matthew chapter 12, starting in verse 25, I'm going to read into verse 29. "And Jesus knew their thoughts." He's talking to the Pharisees. "And Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. And if Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against himself. How shall then his kingdom stand? And if I by Beelzebub cast out devils, by whom do your children cast them out? Therefore they shall be your judges. But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you. Or else, how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house?" So here Jesus is talking to Pharisees about casting out devils and healing people. So doing supernatural and spiritual things. And they're questioning, it's like, you know, pretty much saying like, hey, Jesus is doing this stuff because he works for the devil. He's being demonically possessed or whatever. And Jesus is saying like, that don't make no sense. That don't make no sense. If I was working with the devil, I wouldn't be destroying his kingdom. So it's two different kingdoms fighting. It's the kingdom of the Most High and the kingdom of darkness. The kingdom of light, kingdom of darkness. You know, dark side, light side, whatever. That same discourse, that same idea that Jesus shares in Matthew is shared again in Mark and is also shared again in the Gospel of Luke. So I'm going to look at those individual verses that talk about the strong man being bound. So we have Mark chapter 3, verse 27. It says, "No man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he will first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house." And then Luke chapter 11, verse 21 says pretty much the same thing. "When a strong man armed keeps his palace, his goods are in peace." Verse 22, But when a stronger than he shall come upon him and overcome him, he taketh from him all his armor wherein he trusted and divideth his spoil." The idea is that the only way for anybody to break in somebody's house or whatever and take somebody's stuff is that the strong man who is there, who's supposed to be protecting and guarding the house, they have to be dealt with first. The strong man has to be bound. The strong man has to be incapacitated. So the strong man has to be put out of the way so that the enemy can come in and take what they want to take, their spoils or whatever. But this whole thing of this rise of wicked men that I keep harping on, as this rise of wicked men has been happening in our society and has been impacting our various communities, the strong men, the strong men who are supposed to be serving, protecting, and leading, they are being bound. They have been bound. They have been incapacitated. They have been pulled away from their post. And it's been happening generation after generation after generation, particularly within the Black community. In a general sense, our community has been devastated because the strong men have been bound. And it sucks because when that happens, it leaves so many vulnerable. It leaves so many holes that an enemy can come and take advantage of. My theory is that it starts with the mind. So yeah, you can physically restrain somebody. You know, you can physically incapacitate somebody. You can physically do things to people. But I believe, and I think with this theory, tying it to mental health and emotional health and emotional well-being, one of the most insidious ways that you can bind somebody is by messing up their thoughts, because their thoughts impact the way that what they believe. It impacts their being and impacts what they do. Talking to my wife about this in regards to like demonic influences and stuff like that. And I told her, at least this is my belief and my perspective. It's more diabolical and more impactful to convince someone or someones to have bad thoughts and bad beliefs, to run amok and pretty much do their own self-destruction. It's more diabolical to do that than to individually possess someone. So if I was the enemy, if I was a bad guy, if I was working on the dark side, say I have limited troops, you know, to possess people or to bind people or whatever, it's more efficient for me to convince those on the opposing side to believe things so that they can destroy themselves and so that they can bind themselves and remove themselves from the situation, rather than me going around trying to possess or fight people one-on-one. And that's what the enemy has done and is doing. Now, how does this tie into, like I said, the conspiracy theory kind of stuff? Well, so I watch anime. I watch like a lot of cartoon and sci-fi kind of stuff, right? I was watching this anime. The name of the anime is, it's called Yu Yu Hakusho. I was in like middle school or whenever when this happened. But the general concept, let me see if I can get like a description. All right, summary. One day, 14-year-old Yusuke Urameshi suddenly finds himself dead, having died pushing a child out of the way of oncoming traffic. Since he has such a bad personality, even the spirit world was caught by surprise that he would sacrifice himself. Yusuke soon finds out he wasn't supposed to die and has a chance for resurrection and bringing his body back to life. After being resurrected, Yusuke becomes a spirit detective along with his comrades, and one adventure after another happens, whether it be in an investigation or a fighting tournament. So the concept is, there's this guy who he was kind of a real jerk before he died or whatever, right? He was like bully. He had all these issues or whatever. But anyways, he dies. But because he died doing a good deed, he has this opportunity to come back to life. And so he ends up going on all of these like spiritual, supernatural missions, working for more or less like, I guess it's like heaven, right? So he has to fight bad guys who are demons and stuff like that or whatever, right? And one of the seasons of the show, he and some of his friends are challenged to this tournament. And it's like a tournament of demons fighting, right? There's a lot of supernatural stuff and spiritual stuff topics or whatever that happens in a lot of anime. So it's not foreign. It's not far-fetched. It's just what it is. It's just what it is. But anyways, so they get challenged to go into this tournament or whatever, right? The weird thing about the tournament is, right, there are these various demons that are fighting. And of course, there's Yusuke, main character of the show. He's representing like pretty much humanity. But with all these different teams of demonic contestants or whatever, there are these humans that place bets on these demonic fights and in this supernatural spirit world tournament. One of the characters in this tournament or whatever, one of the people who are placing these bets is this guy who's really, really wealthy. All the people who are placing bets that are involved in this tournament are really, really wealthy. And I would beg to say they are wicked men because they're doing all kinds of dastardly stuff. And they're also hanging out at like demon tournaments. So that's just kind of weird or whatever, right? Why is this relevant to what I want to talk about? In this series from, I think, season 2, it's episode 53 or something like that. And I'm going to play a clip of it. There's a scene where like the head honcho guy who's placing all these bets or whatever on this tournament kind of gives away. He's kind of like monologuing. You know, if you saw the movie Incredibles, Syndrome talks about him, you know, bad guys monologue and they give you their plan and stuff like that. So in the scene, he's monologuing and he tells you his ultimate goal and plan is to get enough money to set up a way for the demon world or the demonic realm to come in to human reality. Why is this significant? I believe this is significant because I think there are actually wicked and evil people who are trying to do that same thing in reality, not just in anime, not just in fiction, not just in entertainment. How does that relate to us and our mental health? How does that relate to our emotional well-being? We have to be on guard. We have to be on guard because there's a lot of wicked men who have risen up in the ranks, who've gained a lot of money, who've gained a lot of influence, who are trying to do very, very evil things in this world, not only to our people, but humanity as a whole. And if we aren't thinking right, if we aren't in the right mindset, we can be deceived and we can be strong men who are bound and pulled away. And we won't be able to serve those that we need to serve. We won't be able to be beneficial if we aren't thinking right. And so I'm going to show some clips and I'm going to tie some other examples of how this concept of bringing evil into this world, how it's really becoming commonplace, even in our entertainment. And I can understand how this can be a little confusing. It's like, wait, Jamal, we've been talking about mental and emotional health and well-being, trying to be beneficial and stuff like that. How in the world did we get here? How in the world did we get here? I think it's important because there's a lot going on in our world. And for us to be beneficial, we need to be aware of it. As I mentioned before, you know, I'm a believer and I believe in the spiritual and I believe in the supernatural. I think as men, particularly as Black men, we are called to engage not only dealing with natural issues, but we're also called to deal with spiritual issues too. As representatives of goodness and righteousness, as men who are supposed to glorify the Most High, and I talk about living for glory and for good, we need to be aware of this stuff. We need to be aware that there's diabolical stuff happening all around us. For us to be the most beneficial, we have to have good perspective. We have to have a good mind. We need to have our minds renewed. Like some stuff we're told to just ignore. Some stuff we are just distracted by, but we need to have our eyes open. I don't know. I might not do a lot of episodes like this. For episode 50, I figured, why not, you know, do something out of the ordinary. So, but yes, I'm going to show this clip from Yu Yu Hakusho and reference some other things. And just keep in mind the name or the word CERN. So this is season 2, episode 53 of Yu Yu Hakusho. Like I mentioned, there is this underworld demonic tournament happening. And there are all of these human, rich, wealthy, again, in my opinion, wicked men placing bets on what's happening. You know, like it's a gladiator fight or whatever. There's this main guy who is placing a lot of money in this bet. And he, in this scene, he's going to explain his diabolical plan.
For days, hoping to get a ticket and wishing they were as lucky as me. Don't forget, it will be broadcasted live on your favorite...
My, you've done well for yourself, haven't you, Sakyo? It's the usual 40 trillion to the winning owner. That should treat you nicely when stacked with the 66 trillion you won from Tarukane before his unfortunate and untimely death.
It is a ridiculous amount of money. What are you going to use it on?
You could do great things, Sakyo. Buy out everything our organization doesn't have already. Every big business a marionette bold by the black market's invisible hands.
Now, don't crowd the man with speeches. I'm sure he knows the potential of this prize. And with the whole world to run, you'll need some trusty CEOs.
Actually, I have much bigger plans.
Oh, really? Well, do tell.
I present my master scheme. A giant tunnel connecting the living world with the demon one.
You're screwing with us!
Please use your imaginations. Do you know why a mere handful of demons escape into the living world at a time, so that one spirit detective and his friends are enough to bring them back? Cost. Portals between the worlds are too expensive. Just creating a temporary tunnel the size of a fist costs $1 million, so only small and very crafty demons can get through. But I have seen creatures the size of shopping malls roam across the demon world. What if a permanent tunnel was made so that every monster could pass at their leisure, regardless of size or strength? What an exciting new world that would be. You want to run the world with money. What if it could be run by fear, by monsters? I want to completely redefine the food chain. But not even 100 trillion is enough. The real wealth is in the bets, but Toguro is such a favorite that no one would bet against him unless there was a wild card.
What a wild card!
Anyways, so that's again, the guy tells you his master plan, his master scheme. He wants to create this giant tunnel that connects the demon world with the real world so that he can leverage evil, leverage these monsters to rule the world with fear, not only with money, but with fear. Okay, so another show I watched that is pretty popular, that has been popular in the past 5 or 6 years, is this show called Stranger Things. Now, unless you're living under a rock, I'm sure you have heard of Stranger Things. It's a Netflix show that's up to 4 seasons. Actually, I think the most recent season that came out was 4 seasons, right? So really, you know, Stranger Things is a very interesting show. It came out in 2016. You know, it has a young girl that has telekinetic powers. And you have these group of guys and other young kids who are involved. And they're having all these weird, weird experiences happening in this small town. And you come to find out, as the show goes on, you find out that there's government things happening there, and they're doing all this testing and experiments. And with those experiments, they, by chance, opened this portal into what in Stranger Things is called the Upside Down, or another dimension where a lot of evil things exist. So like the main bad guy for a long time in the show was this creature called the Demogorgon. So the show goes on, all this crazy stuff happens in this small town. And it's all tied to this gate or this door being opened. One of the most recent seasons, they kind of let you, you know, they give you some kind of backstory, or they give you more details in this in the story, right? And that's when you find out that there have been these experiments, these scientists who are working on using this technology that is supposed to tear small holes into, let's call it the space-time continuum, whatever, right? It creates these little black holes that is supposed to open up and give you the opportunity to enter in another dimension. On the surface, it can seem like, oh, this is really cool science fiction kind of stuff, right? And it seems really weird. This is just a strange concept. But the thing is, this concept has been around for a while. Like I just shared, this idea of creating a tunnel between two different dimensions has existed even from the 90s with this anime called Yu Yu Hakusho. Again, I hadn't seen that whole series, but I was watching it and came across this episode and I was like, oh crap, this is this is the same thing that you would see in Stranger Things. Honestly, it's the same thing that actually exists in real life. There is this device called a Large Hadron Collider that exists, and it's part of a nuclear research center called CERN that is located in Sweden, right? And what they do is they are trying to research, in short, dark matter. They're trying to research what happens when you get very, very small, like atomic particles, slam them together, and you create these tiny tears in our reality, or as they call them, like black holes. And so in Stranger Things, there is this concept, this idea of like a CERN or something that uses the same technology exists, and that's how you get to the Upside Down. That's how you get to the Demogorgon. That's how you get all this stuff. And then that's how you get all the crazy stuff that actually happens in the main town in Stranger Things. So as this gate is open, evil and crazy and weird stuff starts happening, which sounds very similar to what I just showed you in Yu Yu Hakusho. And again, it requires lots and lots of money, lots of energy, and lots of effort. How do I tie this to the rise of wicked men? How do I tie this to making sure that we're thinking good? There are a lot of wicked people who have lots of money, just like that guy in Yu Yu Hakusho, who are investing in things like this happening. And it's weird because, you know, you think, oh, well, maybe these are just like weird coincidences or whatever, right? Just because they talk about it in this TV show or in this anime doesn't mean that people are actually really trying to do this. Well, I thought that too, until I came across this article from the Department of Energy in the United States. And this is from 2017, October 28, 2017. It says, searching for the Upside Down, the science hidden in Stranger Things science fiction. And so this is a picture, the Large Hadron Collider at CERN. In the show Stranger Things, what the Demogorgon comes out of kind of looks similar to this. It's pretty much, it's a tear in reality, and it opens up and bad things can come out. Very similar to what I just showed you in the Yu Yu Hakusho, right? So I'll just read this article real quick. Stranger Things was unquestionably the show of the summer last year. It captured more viewers than almost every other buzzed about Netflix original series and lit up social media for months. The show also sparked interest in the real science behind some of its more outlandish moments, particularly when it came to the subject of extra dimensions. Yes, we're talking about the Upside Down, the nightmarish realm, where our heroes venture to find the missing will buyers. The Upside Down is described in the show as existing in an extra dimension alongside the ones we can see, an extra dimension that can be accessed through a portal. The Upside Down obeys few of the rules of our dimension and seems like an element of the story that is much more fiction than science. What is it? Actually, there is real, hard science behind the idea of extra dimensions, and the Department of Energy's Office of Sciences is involved in studying this very thing, in both theory and experiment. It turns out the ideas presented in the Stranger Things episode, the flea and the acrobat, are pretty much spot on. In the show's analogy, an acrobat on a tightrope can move only forward or backward, but a flea on that same tightrope, working on a much smaller scale, can move all around the rope, in other dimensions, seeing more of them. Since we're the acrobat in this analogy, the question is how to test if extra dimensions really exist. One way of seeing evidence for other dimensions involves gravity, specifically the theoretical particle associated with the force of gravity called the graviton. One theory suggests that the graviton may move in all dimensions, not just the ones we live in. And if we can create gravitons at the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, we might be able to see evidence of them leaving our dimension for other ones. Gravity leaking into extra dimensions could explain why it is such a weak force. Gravity becomes strong in places we can't see, while the other forces, such as electromagnetism, are constrained to our familiar three spatial dimensions. With the LHC, Large Hadron Collider, we can probe what the flea in the above analogy sees by imaging at incredibly tiny scales. If the full force of gravity is as strong as the other forces are, then colliding high-energy particles in a small region of space would create microscopic black holes, harmless ones that decay in a fraction of a trillionth of a second, which would be evidence of gravity slipping into other dimensions. Again, the guy in the anime talked about how much it costs to create small holes, just enough for small demons to come through. They're making small microscopic black holes, but they're trying to make bigger ones. The Large Hadron Collider makes it possible to hunt for this evidence, and DOE, Department of Energy, Office of Science, National Laboratories, are at the forefront of this research as collaborators from the U.S. are leading efforts at the CMS and Atlantis, experiments at the LHC, Large Hadron Collider. That's not all the Office of Science labs are working on that might sound like science fiction. For example, we're involved in the hunt for dark matter, the invisible and as yet undetectable stuff that makes up a quarter of our universe. We're trying to understand dark energy, the force that drives the expansion of the universe. We're building gigantic detectors to understand the neutrino, a particle which may help us understand why we live in a world dominated by matter and not antimatter. In short, with DOE support, real-world scientists today are venturing into terrain almost stranger than fiction, in a serious search for answers to the mysteries of the actual universe we inhabit. So, seeing the Yu Yu Hakusho stuff, seeing Stranger Things, and there are an array of other movies and pieces of entertainment that talk about multiverses and trying to access them and going through them and traveling through them. But you can see that from our own Department of Energy here in the States, they're actually making an effort to explore this. Sure, we may not know what the actual motivation is, but I would theorize that if enough wicked men have enough resources, I think their motivation might be very similar to what we saw in that anime, which you can also see in Stranger Things. Because the thing is, in Stranger Things, the idea is they want to get these demonic forces, these monsters, to add them to their military force so that whenever one country wants to fight another one, they can just release it out and it will just fight. I don't think it's far-fetched that this world full of corrupt people and corrupt men would do something like that. So again, why is this important? Because we as men, even though it may seem daunting and crazy, we as men have to do the work to stand up for what things are good, for things that are righteous, things that are pure, things that are lovely, and protect those who are weak, protect those who need protection. And again, that starts with us thinking right. It really does. This is so important that we renew our minds, that we open our eyes to what's really going on and continue to make an effort to be our best selves. We have to, because this kind of stuff is happening and it's going to keep happening. And we can fight back by shining light on it. We can fight back by informing other people about it. And we can fight back by just preparing ourselves for the craziness that's going to happen in the world. I know it's strange. I know it seems like fiction becoming reality or science fiction becoming reality. But we're seeing it every day. And it seems like time is just moving faster and faster and faster and faster. We got to get our minds right. we have to prepare ourselves. In the scriptures, when it was time for war for the Israelites, and there are a few scriptures that talk about the men having to train their hands for war. I think that's important, but I also think we need to train our minds to serve for glory and for good. Again, I know this episode was probably a little far out there. Might be a little disjointed. The encouragement is we need to get our minds right, because there's an enemy out there that doesn't want us to be strong men, that doesn't want us to stand up, that doesn't want us to protect those who matter to us, and doesn't want that to happen. Black man, you're called for more than mediocre living. You're here for a purpose, to live for glory and for the good of others. Let's do the work and keep choosing to become beneficial for our community. I believe in you. I believe in you. Until next time, go make something for yourself, of yourself, and for glory and for good. Protect your mental, find time for an emotional release valve, and keep becoming beneficial. Peace.